It's great to be here, and we're just so happy to see the audience, the size and the diversity in the audience and the interest in this topic, and we're just really glad the day has come. So I'd like to introduce our first speaker. It's with great pleasure that I introduce Dr. Karen Fredriksen Goldsen. She is professor and director of the professor at the University of Washington and director of the Hartford Center of Excellence there. She specializes in innovations in health equity and aging research across marginalized communities. Currently, she is leading the National Health, Aging, and Sexuality Study, Caring and Aging with Pride Over Time. This is the first ever longitudinal study to address the emerging needs of LGBT baby boomers and those of the silent generation, and it is funded nationally by the National Institute on Aging. Dr. Goldsen is author of more than 75 peer-reviewed publications in leading journals like the American Journal of Public Health, and also she has published 3 books and presented her research findings at the White House and at congressional briefings. She's received numerous awards for not only her innovative scholarship, but also her teaching and inclusiveness and her ability to engage the community and to really address health, well-being, and service needs. So her keynote address is entitled Health Equity and Aging Among LGBT Older Adults, Addressing Dementia Awareness and Priority Needs in Diverse Communities. So I hope you will join me in welcoming Dr. Fredriksen Goldsen.
First of all, I want to thank all of you. It's wonderful to be here to see everyone. I have a long history here in California. I did some of my graduate school training here, and I also was part of the work group and in terms of for the San Francisco Task Force. And I remember back in 1986 when I was first asked to do my first talk on LGBT aging. And it was perfect timing because that very same week, President Reagan at the time came out with a proclamation that the homosexual party was over. Now, I'm still mad about that because I don't know who had that party and why I wasn't invited. But times have changed, and just this last week, I had the opportunity to present some of my findings at the White House as well as at a congressional briefing and several other, places where policy and policy changes can be made. But before I start, I want to first thank Mellon and Dolores and all the other members of the planning team. As I said, I love coming here. I think you're out in front. I think this event today is really, really illustrates that as well as so much of the other work. I want to thank Marcy Edelman in particular, who is part of our project. We are collaborating with 16 community agencies across the country, and Open House and Michelle and others at Open House also are part of this effort, and I'll talk more about that. I also want to thank the National Institutes of Health and the National Institutes of Aging for funding our first project on LGBT aging, and now funding the first longitudinal study on LGBT aging. And more than ever, I really want to also thank all of the sponsors, but more than anything, I want to thank the older adults, the LGBT older adults, their family members and caregivers that have so graciously been part of our project. So again, thank you to everyone. Today, I'm here to address health equity and aging among LGBT older adults, addressing dementia awareness and priority needs. These are culturally diverse communities, and I appreciate many of Michelle's remarks in terms of just the amount of cultural diversity by so many different dimensions when we talk about the LGBT community. And sometimes I think this acronym, as useful as it might be, oversimplifies the diversity that we're talking about. And in fact, it might be outdated before I finish this talk. But today, I'm going to really talk about 3 main pieces. I'm going to talk first about our project so that you have a better understanding of the work that we're currently doing. Then I'm going to look at some of the specific needs of LGBT older adult, midlife and older adults in our studies that are facing cognitive impairment and some who are facing dementias. And then I'm going to look at what are some of the key competencies that are really essential to move this work forward. I only have a limited time, I could say I've only have a few minutes and perhaps I've already used it, but I want to step back and look at each of these pieces. So first of all, just to put my work in perspective, as Dolores had said, I'm part of several different studies, and I look at marginalization and historical disadvantage in terms of aging and health. And in addition to the health and aging sexuality study, we also have a project, I'm an investigator, on a healthy hearts project to reduce cardiovascular risk in Native American communities. And we've also had been working in China on HIV adherence to medication, training family caregivers how to support medication adherence to HIV medications in China. So that just gives you a kind of a sense of the different kinds of communities, and I think this really actually strengthens our work and how we think about and address the issues that we're talking about. So first of all, just to step back, we certainly have global, worldwide aging, and we know that. And we also have increasing diversity by race and ethnicity. We also have increasing diversity by sexuality and gender identity, and within that, by race and ethnicity, as well as by ability status and socioeconomic status. We estimate that there's about 2.4 million LGBT older adults that self-identify nationally, and within, by 2030, that'll be over 5 million that self-identify. Within this context, we see rapid policy change. We have marriage equality now in 35 states, plus Washington, D.C., legislation across every state, and now the Supreme Court will be looking at this again in terms of a national response. So within this, we have such rapid change, but I think sometimes popular culture, perhaps, reflects this. Just remember 50 years ago with the icon of the American family. Okay, and now who do we have? Oh, Mitch and Cam. But of course, what's important to remember here is who is pictured, who is portrayed, and who is not portrayed. Because again, in both of these cases, we don't see any racial or ethnic diversity, and we don't see really any diversity by age, as well as by ability status. So we're making progress, and progress is important, and we need to acknowledge it. And we also need to see and keep track of how we need and where we need and how we're going to be moving forward. So in terms of health priorities, and part of this ever-changing diversity, we are seeing a shift in U.S. health priorities. First of all, the Institute of Medicine identified LGBT older adults in the report as at risk and underserved. And in Healthy People 2020, for the first time, we see the inclusion of sexual and gender identity in our national health priorities. These are very important changes. And the CDC states that there's growing recognition for the need of data sources of the including LGBT populations, and they specifically identify LGBT older adults. This is one of our first seminal peer review papers, which was the first to reveal health disparities among lesbian, gay, bisexual adults aged 50 and older. We know that individuals across marginalized populations are at risk of poor health, disability, and premature death. But when I say health disparities, I'm defining health outcomes for communities that, as a result of social, economic, and environmental disadvantage, systematically encounter obstacles to health. I'll say more about the specific disabilities. But about the disparities in a minute. But we also found a higher probability of disability, early onset of disability among lesbian, gay, and bisexuals when compared to heterosexuals. And before this, most of the research was focusing on coping processes and how it relates to mental health, which is very important. But there was a lack of attention to physical health also, and the interrelationships between mental and physical health. So I want to tell you a little bit about our newest project. As Dolores said, our project, the National Health, Aging, and Sexuality Study, which we call NHAS, and we say NHAS because it has sexual identity and sexual orientation questions, it's caring and aging with pride over time. This is the first ever longitudinal study, and the goal is to identify mechanisms associated with variability in health and quality of life over time. This is so that we can support the development of interventions that are sustainable within community-based settings. We utilize a dual sampling design, so we are both working through partial agency lists, but we're also using social network clustering, so we can reach out to those that aren't connected with service organizations. And we have 16 sites, as I mentioned. It is the first large national study, but we also now have 3 sites in the South, including Georgia, Texas, and Kentucky, which is also a first. And we stratify this study, those that are participating by age, so that we have 3 different cohorts. We have the baby boomers, we have the silent generation, and we have the greatest generation. We also are stratifying by gender, by race and ethnicity. We're doing a lot of outreach. About almost 25% of our sample are people of color, primarily African Americans, Hispanics, also Native American, Two-Spirits, and Asian and Pacific Islanders. What we're doing is, in addition to, we have surveys that are available through both mail and online. And we also, we've had 2,400, over 2,400 people that are part of the ongoing project. We'll be following up with people every other year. In addition to the surveys, we have in-home interviews where we're gathering functional, biological, and cognitive measures. So our study is also benchmarked with the National Health Interview Study and with the Health and Retirement Study. So we'll be adjusting our findings based on population estimates. And we're also adjusting for people that don't respond to these kinds of surveys. So again, that's probably more detail than you wanted, but I think I want you to see the depth of the study, only of which part I can report on today. But I'm excited to share some of the preliminary findings from our first wave of this longitudinal study about the context of care for those with cognitive impairment and dementia. And again, there are preliminary findings because we are finalizing our analyses and weighting our sample, and that has not been done. But just to give you a little more background, as was mentioned, I work from a health equity perspective. And why health equity, I think, is important is it explores the full continuum of health outcomes and situates our research towards elders reaching their full health potential. I think it's very important that we don't over-medicalize and over-problematize LGBT people, because while they're at risk for health disparities, they're very resilient. So this particular framework allows us to look both at positive health outcomes as well as negative health outcomes and everything in between. And in fact, we just had a research paper that was published in the Gerontologist on well aging in these communities. But what this allows us to do, this particular perspective that we've developed and that we're utilizing, is it allows us to think about both intersecting social positions and to start thinking more clearly about different subgroups and socioeconomic differences, but then how these different social positions intersect with structural and environmental contexts, as well as adverse and health-promoting pathways to influence both positive and negative health outcomes. We're looking at physical health, mental health, and quality of life. And the importance of the context over the life course is shown toward the bottom of this figure and is critical. Because a life course perspective helps us situate our work within the social context, cultural meaning, and structural location, in addition to time, period, and cohort, and how this affects aging processes, including health and well-being. Situating LGBT older adults, and really, we're looking 50 and older. We have half of our sample that is part of midlife baby boomers, and half of our sample that is silent generation or the greatest generation. So we have both. So we have over 1,200 people who are in the silent and greatest generations. But the pre-Stonewall adults, especially those over the age of 67 and older, really did come of age at a time when same-sex relationships were criminalized and severely stigmatized and criminalized, with same-sex identities, gender nonconformity, and gender differences socially invisible. When we asked one of our oldest participants, who is 95, how old were you when you first considered yourself gay? His response was 15 years old. When we asked how old were you when you first told someone you were gay? His response was 90 years old. But let me juxtapose this, because these issues in LGBT aging are about balancing, because we had also some people in that very same cohort, one woman in particular, who was threatened by her husband that she was going to lose her children But she said, I'm sorry, I am a lesbian, I'm in a relationship. He took her to court. As it turned out, she luckily did not lose her children. But we've had people, I just want to encourage us to continue to think about the diversity, because it's very easy to fall into stereotypes in this work. So I'll try to balance that, but it's complex. So we found that lesbian, gay, bisexual older adults are, well, most are actually enjoying good health. They are elevated risk of disability, mental distress, and are more likely to engage in some adverse behaviors, including smoking, excessive drinking, and some substance abuse. And some of these risks and adverse behaviors can increase risk of cognitive impairment and dementias. And these disparities and elevated risks are linked with experiences of victimization and stigma, especially if we consider that events at one given stage of life can have a profound effect on other stages. Across these communities, there's limited information about aging, about comorbidities, a distinct lack of dementia awareness. And I think it's very important, and we're starting to look at this, how such issues combined with serious risk of unmet needs, comorbidities, and social isolation can be linked to premature mortality. But while the term LGBT is often used, as we've mentioned already, these are distinct groups, often with unique needs. First important, as I said, most are healthy, but yet they're a health disparate population. Lesbian and bisexual women are at elevated risk of obesity, cardiovascular disease, while gay and bisexual men are at higher risk of poor health, general poor health, and living alone. It was interesting that we found lesbian and bisexual older women are at higher risk of disability than gay and bisexual men, which is surprising to us because of HIV. We also found transgender and bisexual older adults, as was mentioned, are also at higher risk of health disparities, but they're also less likely to self-disclose. But in addition to diversity, bisexual identity, we also now, for the first time, have more than 25% people of color. And African Americans, Hispanics, Asian Americans, and Native American Two-Spirits are also at risk. But what's really been interesting, as we've started to look at these age group differences by cohort, it's not quite as straightforward as we might have thought, because we're seeing very different configurations of risk, and we're seeing health disparities both across the baby boomers as well as across the silent generation. And in part, this different configuration of risk, I think, is very important, because the silent generation experience more stigma and less identity disclosure, but they've also experienced less overt discrimination and victimization. While baby boomers had higher rates of explicit or overt discrimination and victimization, but less stigma and more identity disclosure. So what we're having and what we're finding is very unique patterns of risk, both resulting in health disparities. And this has been important, but let's take a look. I just want to talk for a moment about a closer look at older adults with cognitive impairment and dementia in our study. First, I can only discuss those in our self-report survey at this point because we're out in the field right now, including our in-home interviews and doing our cognitive and functional and biological measures in the field. But in our survey, LGBT older adults were asked about cognitive functioning, and they were also asked if they'd ever been told by a doctor if they had Alzheimer's disease or other dementia. For cognitive functioning, we were using the WHO DOS-2 cognitive questions, which assess six domains of human cognition: concentration, memory, problem solving, skill acquisition, comprehension, and communication. Of those 50 and older, 7% reported severe cognitive impairment in at least one of these areas, 33% had at least moderate cognitive impairment, and 73% reported at least mild cognitive impairment. With those 80 and older, 10% reported severe cognitive impairment, 40% moderate, and 83% mild impairment. So when we further examine severe cognitive impairment, we're seeing differences by background characteristics. And this is going to be important to do more work, because we have to understand, is this measurement or is this differences? And we'll really only know when we're out in the field. But we did see that African American, Hispanic, and Native American Two-Spirits are more likely to report severe cognitive impairment. And we're also seeing other hidden subgroups. We're reaching out to those hidden. Proportions of severe cognitive impairment also were higher among transgender older adults, but they did not differ by biological sex in the sample. And even though there's higher proportion of gay and bisexual men living with HIV. And it's certainly documented, although it's been, the impact's been decreasing with medications, that people living with HIV and AIDS are at maybe at higher risk of developing neuropathology, leading to compromised cognitive performance in some cases. Other factors include chronic inflammation, immune activation due to HIV infection, co-infection with HVC, histories of substance abuse or drug effects of HIV treatments. So in our project, we did find having HIV and AIDS is strongly correlated with severe cognitive impairment, although we're finding comparable levels of cognitive impairment across both by biologic sex. But when we look, have you ever been told by a doctor if they have Alzheimer's disease or other dementia, our findings are much lower than the national U.S. population. And again, I think part of this is selection bias. I'll talk about that. But from 50 to 79, about 0.7% reported that they've been told by a doctor that they have Alzheimer's disease or other dementia. And about those 80 and older, over 1% also said that they were told. But we would expect a selection bias here for various reasons. First of all, for those with severe cognitive impairment, it may be very difficult to complete the surveys. We also may have a survival effect here. And among those least likely to seek routine health care, they may not have received a diagnosis. This is why the longitudinal study is as important as it is. We're going to be following these LGBT older adults over time to better understand both their cognitive and health trajectories. But as I think about our preliminary findings, I'm reporting those who self-report. But also, there's other, most of the findings I'm talking about are those that report cognitive impairment. But again, this could include people with dementia, but also those that may be having cognitive impairment for other reasons, such as from medication or other illnesses, or those who may not be may have a more mild form of cognitive impairment than Alzheimer's or dementia. But you know, our participants, like older adults in general, they worry about Alzheimer's and dementia. At age 91, my life, one of our participants shared, my life seems quite remarkable at 91, but I am concerned about losing my ability to think clearly. So there's this fear combined with lack of dementia awareness and education across these communities. So when we think about the context of care, as was mentioned for LGBT older adults, there's several issues, but I want to look at specifically at those with cognitive impairment in our study. Again, it's preliminary. Overall, we find that discrimination and victimization for older adults in general is the strongest predictor of poor health outcomes. But when we compare those with cognitive impairment and those without, those with severe cognitive impairment have experienced the most lifetime victimization, the most day-to-day discrimination, and the greatest level of microaggressions, which are the daily insults and indignities that LGBT people often experience, including inappropriate jokes. They also experience the highest internalized stigma. It is critical to consider that many living with cognitive impairment, many of those that we serve in the field of Alzheimer's and working with people with Alzheimer's and dementia, that many of those have trauma histories that must be considered. One participant shared, I'm over 50, a trans health activist, afraid that my insistence on being who I am will confuse people, especially as I get older. I'm afraid of dementia, Alzheimer's. What if I go back to my 10 or 20-year-old self as a girl or as a woman? What then? As I said, we see remarkable resilience and many strengths among the LGBT older adults in our study, including those, of course, with cognitive impairment, as well as our caregivers. They're often involved in wellness activities, spiritual or religious activities. And in fact, those with cognitive impairment have the same level of engagement with spiritual and religious activities as those who are not cognitively impaired. And one of our older gay participants shared, I joined the Metropolitan Community Church in 1969, and I've been very active for 25 years. Boy, have we come a long ways. But those with cognitive impairment in our study are actually more likely to be using services, yet more than a quarter say they have experienced being denied health care or provided inferior health care because of their sexual or gender identities. Overall, as a group, they're more likely to conceal their sexual and gender identities and not explicitly disclose as an LGBT person. And as I said, bisexual and transgender older adults are also less likely to disclose, and this is true for those with cognitive impairment. Physicians' failure to recognize and patients' reluctance to disclose can complete incomplete assessments, as well as providers. A 56-year-old trans woman shared, "I've had an overwhelmingly positive experience with my transgender gender transition so far, but I would say my primary concern about the future is with access to healthcare and potential discrimination as a senior, especially if the need arises for long-term care." So certainly we see unique support systems, and this is also something that I think is very important. Cognitive impairment in those with living with cognitive impairment in our study did have lower levels of social participation, less social support, and are more likely to live alone. Nearly 40% of those with severe cognitive impairment are relying on an informal caregiver. And nearly 90% of the caregivers, as we know in the general population, what that looks like in terms of by birth or by marriage, but only 14% of the care was provided among the older adults in general in the general community by a non-relative. But as was mentioned, LGBT older adults, their care relies heavily on partners and friends, most of similar age, and this is important. While these caregivers provide extensive care, some of the caregiving friends in our study did share that they may have limits in their ability to provide care over the long term, especially when and if decision making is required. A 66-year-old lesbian in our study said, "Isolation, finding friend support, caregiving, and health are the biggest issues old gay people face. Who will be there for us? Who will help us without judgment?" Oh, one other thing about the caregivers that I do think is really important. Among LGBT older adult participants, Hispanics and Native Americans were actually the most likely and more likely to provide care than white LGBT people. And among caregivers in our study, 35% were providing care to their partner or spouse, and nearly one-third to a friend. In terms of biological family members, 16 were providing care to a parent or parent-in-law, 7% to another relative, and 2% were assisting an adult child, which is also important to consider. Just over one-third were living with the person with whom they helped. They were helping from anywhere from 1 month to 60 years. One in five were providing 10 to 20 hours of care, and about one in five, more than 20 hours of care. And 12% were spending more than $500 a month. But the LGBT caregivers compared to non-caregivers, interestingly, also have higher rates of victimization and discrimination. And 44% of the caregivers indicate that the person that they're helping is also the person that helps them if they're ill. So the dual roles in caregiving are very important to consider. So I'm going to go back to these unique needs. So what are the unique needs? LGBT older adults in general report senior housing, transportation, legal services, social events, support groups. Those with severe cognitive impairment report needing social activity programs, peer support groups, and more culturally tailored health services. Caregivers also have different needs. They report ranking as most important supportive long-term care facilities, case management services, personal care, adult care, and in-home care services. So we have to look at these needs by the different roles people are playing, which I think makes sense. So as we move forward, I just want to highlight a few competencies. First of all, competency one, critically analyze professional and professional attitudes. I think we've talked about this, but I do want to say specifically that when we think of it's also important to think of those within professionals, but also so many of the older adults in our study talk about their concerns about working with and being in environments where they're working with, where they're with heterosexual older adults who also may have biases, and that we need to think about training providers as well as other clients, other residents, and One thing I want to say here that I do think is it's really important to meet clients where they're at. I know that many of us, you know, disclosure in many ways is related to positive health outcomes. But it's related to positive health outcomes if people are not extremely vulnerable and they're in a safe place. If they are not in a safe place, it will lead to poorer health outcomes. So this is very important to consider vulnerability and protection and safety of all of our elders. I've already talked quite a bit about social context. I want to say that, as certainly as care providers, as informal caregivers, how important it is to meet people where they're at. And that so often we spend time thinking about the larger social context without thinking about equally important what's going on in the LGBT community. And certainly alienation can emanate from one's own community, so there's both ageism, racism within LGBT communities. And like all individuals with dementia, some may want to talk or tell stories. Others may not want to share their experience. For others, their memories may be distant or unclear, but the emotional reactions and triggers can be very strong. So I think it's important to think what Volser also terms as rejection of care. What do we do if patients resist care from providers or show regression or from caregivers? And strategies, certainly we know about tones of voices and explaining actions of providers to the actions that are taking. Here we have to think about both differences in terms of one's body and allowing clients, if they're able or if they desire, to wash parts of their own body or to talk about their body if they so want. As a male baby boomer who participated in the project shared, I was part of the first post-wall Stonewall baby boomer who participated. And he said, I was part of the first Stonewall generation and feel it's extremely important for my generation to continue to create dialogue and programs, especially access to healthcare. But again, we have to be flexible. We have to, and this is hard. I'm talking about balancing a lot of things today. And I'm balancing a lot of things up here right now. Yes. And then when we think about subgroups, I've already said a lot about subgroups, but I want to say, and I've said a lot about intersecting identities, but I want to say one other thing about balance, and that's understand subgroup differences. Talk to people that are working within different communities, but don't assume everybody within a subgroup is going to be the same. Because it just, most conversations that I'm hearing recently about, well, which group has it worse? I step back and I say, I think you need to start thinking more deeply about trying to understand both groups, both individuals, but the unique configuration of risk and protective factors. We have risk and we have resilience, and how do those come together? It's very important. But one thing we hardly ever talk about in LGBT work is socioeconomic differences. This is driving a lot of the differences that we see, particularly when we look at differences among bisexuals and transgender older adults. But it's across every group that I'm talking about. And I just want to say, a 76-year-old lesbian shared, I've been homeless, staying briefly on the streets, in the car, and in a shelter until my daughter began to help. And I shared at the White House. In fact, we're seeing growing homelessness in our populations. And this intersection between lack of housing stability and cognitive impairment and dementia is something that I think we're just starting to think about. I've already talked a little bit about the framework I use, and there's so many different frameworks to think about. But I do want to say that I think it is important that in dementia care in particular, and for dementia partnerships, that we, and those that, you know, all of us in the field know how different things can change and can change very rapidly. And how do we be open to that and be flexible enough to respond to that, I think is very important. And so certainly we see changes in coping mechanisms. We see changes in how people identify. Additionally, behavioral symptoms sometimes are some of the most challenging and sometimes are the most costly aspects of providing care in any setting. But we have to think about background factors such as neurological and cognitive, as well as our psychosocial history, how this intersects with physiological, neurological, cognitive factors, and the social and built environment. I'm so pleased to see the growing number of community organizations, including Open House and many others, that are successfully developing cultural competency training. But what we have to remember is we have to balance. LGBT older adults have a lot in common with other older adults that also are experiencing Alzheimer's or dementia or cognitive impairment. But they also have the unique factors that I'm talking about. But again, it's a matter of balance. So what do we think about assessment? I never listened to anything, I'm told. Somebody just said I only had 1 minute, but I'm sure I have three. But we're going to... So let's see where... Oh, assessment. I've already talked about assessment, but I want to say just a few things. Certainly, get a full assessment as early as possible. And then I think another thing, I'm just going to mention the most important things here. Understand all of the strengths and needs and understand all potential resources. And don't oversimplify it, not thinking that biological family may or may not be involved. We don't know. Find out. But make sure that we're open to the care networks and all the other care providers. But one thing that I think is really critical here, too, is in... Well, I'll actually say it in a minute, but the National Resource Center on LGBT Aging was already mentioned. But I'm going, there's one other thing about programs that I think is also very important here. Providers, in particular, one thing that I think it's very, two things that I think are very important here. First of all, don't assume because somebody has self-disclosed to you that they have self-disclosed to every other provider or informal caregiver or other family member. And sometimes family members don't know about a person's sexual identity or gender identity until a person has very advanced cognitive impairment or dementia. So you're the one in the middle here balancing this, but confidentiality is absolutely critical. Trust is critical. Creating safety is critical. So... And one other thing, too, that I want to mention here is when we first found out that about 30% of the people in our study don't have wills or durable powers of attorney for healthcare, we were like, oh, my goodness, they don't understand. They don't understand the legal planning, or they're too scared to be out, or whatever we thought. But what we found is about a third don't have anyone to name. So we have to be thinking about other forms of alternative decision-making and guardianships. Policies. As I said, policies are already changing. Which is so important, but we have to remember in the marriage policy, but we have to remember discrimination by employment in public accommodations is still, and housing is still legal in many places across the country, so we have to work to change that. We also have to realize that many people have already lost partners. They're not going to be able to recoup socioeconomically from those losses. They won't ever have access to the kinds of benefits. We also have to remember that friends as caregivers are absolutely critical in these communities. And how do we shift Family Medical Leave Act both nationally to make sure that we can ensure that there's coverage for other kinds of caregivers than those that the systems were originally designed? So again, both the National Advocacy Organization and Diverse Elder Coalition are really good resources. Language, I think we know about the importance of language. But many people, well, a lot of people still, you know, it's not uncommon to stumble over LGBT, but equally important, I listen to the people that I work with, and I listen as early as I can, and I try to utilize their language. There's APA guidelines that I think are very helpful in terms of vocabulary and how important it is to convey respect without at the same time avoiding language that marginalizes, such as terms like sexual preference, which implies choice. Outreach. Again, how important it is to have symbols that show that it's safe, if it's safe. And I say this because I'm seeing the symbols in so many places. But I have to see the corresponding training, and I have to see that training's going on regularly because there's high turnover in many organizations. So this is very critical. One person that's been active in PFLAG, a person shared, a couple that's been active in PFLAG gave me a rainbow sticker. I'm in a retirement. I'm out for the first time in my life. My only sadness is a lack of a cuddly friend, though I've recently fallen in love with an 85-year-old pianist who hasn't noticed me yet, but will. So I just want to last end with capacity building. I think that's what we're doing today. I think that's what we're doing with our study as we work across 16 different geographic locations all over the United States. We give our information back to each and every location to help them be able to develop the information, have the information they need, and get the resources that they need. A 63-year-old lesbian put it this way: our community needs to acknowledge our next step, being old and embracing it gracefully. But as we move forward, as I said, we have to think about creating culturally competent care. We have to think about responsive services, programs, and policies. And we have to develop interventions to those unique needs. There's so much, as I said, to balance as we think about all of this. And that's what makes this work so wonderful and so gratifying. But nothing makes it more gratifying than the people that I get to meet and work with in this project. Both the older, the LGBT older adults, their caregivers, their family members, their children, their communities. And to see what's going on across this nation and how we have to be vigilant and keep this work moving forward. But I want to end this talk with a quote by a 70-year-old gay person in our study. In spite of some of the hassles I've had in my life because I'm gay, I consider being gay a gift. It's made my life richer and opened so much of the world for me. Of course, if I had to do it over again, there's some things I would have done differently, but being gay is not one of them. Please define what I mean by a longitudinal study. Thank you so much. What I mean by a longitudinal study is that this study will be over time. We completed our first parent study, but that was one time, that was a cross-sectional study. It was one point in time. And that gave us a lot of really important information. In fact, we didn't know if people would participate if we asked for recontact information. But we did ask people if they were willing. And in fact, about almost 90% said they were willing to be recontacted. But the longitudinal study now, we just did our first point, but this will be, it's over time. So now we're looking at changes over time. So we'll do it every other year. We're funded now for, we'll do three different times where we do the surveys. It, 1 year and then every other year. So what's super important by this is that we can see how people actually change over time. Because right now we know, like, there's victimization may be a link, but we don't really know what precedes what. Is it a risk for, like, microaggressions, which are like an insult, or is it really lifetime victimization where somebody was victimized? Now we can actually start to figure out what precedes what. What's the antecedents? What happens? And then what happens next? And we can get a much better idea of trajectories, because my own belief is we may have a lot of myths going on in LGBT aging. We may think this causes this, but it may be something else entirely. So this is why this kind of a study is important. And I very much plan to carry this study for the next 30 years. We're funded in 5-year increments. As I say, it took a long time to get it funded. And the good news is I'm now old enough to complete my own surveys. Thank you so much. This comment recognizes the importance of getting the southern states. And again, it's been our southern partners that have really helped move that forward, but we're very excited because this will be the first time where we can start to look at geographic difference and how much the context of the geographic distance and the policy debates that are going on in each area of the country, how much this influences LGBT health and aging, and certainly for those with cognitive impairment. And are we still identifying participants for the study? You're welcome to contact our office if people are interested in participating. We're still doing outreach into very specific communities where we're doing in-home interviews. And I continually ask anyone that's interested in participating in this or future projects to let us know, because we will have very many future projects. Because as you can see, there's a whole nother project here for this cognitive impairment piece and so many others.
Okay, this will be the last one.
What's so interesting, questions are always my favorite part. So thank you for giving me so many good ones. Who are, and I'll be available at the break if you want to ask me other questions, but who is the silent generation? And I think that's a really good question, because we use baby boomers quite a bit, you know. But when we look at the silent generation, it's really those 67, 68 and older. We really have to go by birth year, but about 67, 68 at this particular point in time and older, which is post-Stonewall. And I'm using two things there by defining the silent generation, both how the silent generation and, quote, other work is defined, but we're also really using post-Stonewall as part of this, too, because we're looking at the convergence of events that are occurring, you know, across communities, as well as events that have occurred within the LGBT community. And there's many other things to consider, but those are the silent, that is the silent generation. And we have a lot of diversity within the silent generation. Right now, I can talk about age group differences. This may be a little bit more than you want. I can talk about these age groups. I can't really look at the differences between cohorts yet. And that is because I have to have cohorts at the same age. And in wave three, I will have people in the baby boomer generation that were 67 to 71, and I'll also have silent generation that were age 67 to 71. Now I can see what was age difference and what is truly cohort difference. So I think this is what's really interesting, I think, in this project, is we have an opportunity to go further and start to really understand the lives of the participants in our project and the way they have shared their experiences and their histories and their willingness to really create a legacy of the future. We've had people that have never been out that participate in our projects. And I ask why, how did you get here? Why are you? And they say, because we want to create a legacy for the future. And I think that's what this is about. So thank you. Thank you to everyone that's participated and everyone that's come today.